set aside. In our tradition, of course, Memorial Day is to commemorate those who have fallen, those soldiers who have gone before us. So every week, every Sunday, we are reminded about one who gave his life also. I've heard it said many times that the closest thing to the sacrifice that Jesus made was the American soldier. And I think that's been true in many cases. But I know people from all around the world, and it's not just the American soldier. I mean, there are many soldiers who give their life for freedom. There are many soldiers who have given their life even for their enemies. It does sound a little bit like Jesus, doesn't it? Sent his son. I know if you think about it, how much the disciples have felt on the day when he was taken away. Not just when they crucified him, but when he was resurrected and they saw him again. And then again taken away. Sometimes our life seems to be like that. It's as if something was handed to you, only to have it removed. Here's one thing that you can take with you. You can take the love of God and others. There are three things that remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these things is love. Can we just pray this morning? Father, we thank you, God, that you have provided for us a way for salvation. We also thank you, Lord, that you have provided for us a way to help one another to realize what a wonderful life we have been given. Lord, we are wise to remind one another never to forget who we are and never to forget who we're not. Lord, your word says you'll bring down the stubborn pride and make the sky above the proud like an iron and the ground beneath like bronze. Lord, your word is drawing a benediction. And Lord, although you have given, sometimes things are taken. We offer to you today the sacrifice of praise in the name of all that is good, and there's only one that is good, and it's you, Lord. And we thank you in Jesus' name, and the church all said, thank you. 27 says this, in the third and fourth verse, it says, though an army besieges me, my heart will not fear. Though war breaks out against me, even then will I be confident. Listen, church, listen, saints. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. I can preach on that for a minute. For those of you who are here this morning, this was the desire of a man who was a warrior king, that he would dwell in the house of the Lord all his days. I don't know if you can interpret this any other way but to realize what it means for us to be gathered together on a day like this. Notice that he had seen wars. He had done things himself that he regretted, that caused him to turn around and say, Lord, this is my greatest desire, that I might dwell in your house. This and only this do I seek. I wonder how many soldiers have been out there. How many soldiers there are out there now that they're hoping on a day like today that there will be those gathering in prayer, those gathering to inquire of the Lord, to seek him in his temple. You see, they're out there fighting a battle. But can I tell you that there's a real battle going on in here? And those who are not in here have given up on the battle. They've given in. They said, well, Jesus did it all on the cross. There's nothing left to do. That is not what Jesus says. That is not what God would have us to do. Because the word of God tells us, and James teaches, he says, that faith without works. We also learn, Paul says, that we should gather even more often than we do. But so many of us have made this just another thing that we do on a Sunday or during a holiday or something else. But can I tell you, this is something that we should make it a point of. Gathering regularly. Amen? As I had said, and I'm going to make this comment, then I want to show a clip, and we're going to pray this morning, but as a church, not just our church, but any church, the way it works is typically a church gets together, and many, many times by tradition or just by absolute necessity, it looks to provide for a need for people, and so we tend to be a hospital. Oh, certainly we're a lighthouse to keep the lights on for you. But when you come in, you hope to get something. You hope to get maybe a little bit of peace. Maybe you need healing. Maybe you just need a little bit of comfort. Maybe just some reassurance. And we come and we get that from time to time. Amen. That's the hospital. But the longer you stick around, the more you realize, I kind of like being around folks like this. And I've kind of fallen in love with these people. That's when you become family. Amen. But then the trouble really begins. Amen. And until you can grow up in your faith and mature, that goes for those of us who have been in the house of God. We've been in the faith for so long. Until you grow up and mature, you're not going to use, you won't use the verses like Matthew chapter 7. That, you know why? You can't judge me. No, wait, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you've already been judged. Amen. Too many of us, we haven't matured in our faith, and we want to use these verses to say, I can live my life any way I want to. You can't judge me. That's not what the Bible says. Even in that chapter, one thing it says in that chapter, knock, seek, and ask. And keep on knocking, seeking, and asking. And you know the way you're going to be able to do that? Listen, how many of you love it when those people come knocking on your door, offering you something? Many times that's how we treat God. Well, when we want to sell him something, or our idea or our way we think or how we want things to happen. We want I'm just come here today because I want to sell something and I want you to bless. No, wait, you're not going to sell it on that until you're sold out to what he wants to bless you with. Did you hear that? So when we become this family, we grow up, we mature, and we learn that there's always going to be a pecking order in the house of in the family. Maybe you have people who are the matriarchs, patriarchs, but there always seems to be that person who seems to be able to have a little bit better handle on how things should go. And they're the ones calling the shot, and quite often in our families, and maybe you've had people in your household or in your family lineage. And maybe she just seemed to be, or he just seemed to be a little bit closer to God and made it look easy. But they're gone. And now you're left standing alone. But you know you're not. That is why we have the church. Can you imagine how many American soldiers would love to be here right now?
Amen.
And perhaps where they are. Some of you here this morning, you have served in the military in different capacities. You know, I just learned out something else. Did you know, I'm over 60 years old, did you know that right now the military would take me?
Yep.
I said, excuse me? Now, obviously, there are things that I probably can't do anymore. Don't be laughing. Especially if you're younger, because you can probably do it all. But I had a conversation with someone. And the reason, it's not just that they just want bodies. FYI, that's not what the church just wants. It's just a bunch of bodies. We're looking for souls. Because that's what Jesus came for, isn't it? But did you know this? What I have discovered is as long as you're taking breath and nourishment, in this life you have purpose. And you have worth. And you've been called. Each and every one of us, we've been called. Today we're called to commemorate the soldiers that have gone and given us the right. Certainly we have free speech, but how many of you know we have a right to assemble and to worship? Isn't that something?
Yes.
Can you give God a hand clap of praise? Now, would you give the American soldier a hand clap?
Sadness that accompanies the death of servicemen, for we're never quite good enough to them. Not really, we can't be, because what they gave us is beyond our powers to repay. So when a serviceman dies, he's a tear in the fabric, a break in the whole, and all we can do is remember. It is, in a way, an odd thing to honor those who died in defense of our country, in defense of us, in wars far away. Imagination plays a trick. We see these soldiers in our mind as old and wise. We see them as something like the founding fathers, gray and gray-haired. But most of them were boys when they died, and they gave up two lives, the one they were living and the one they would have lived. When they died, they gave up their chance to be husbands and fathers and grandfathers. They gave up their chance to be revered old men. They gave up everything for our country, for us. We owe them a debt we can never repay. All we can do is remember them, what they did, and why they had to be brave for us.
Thank you.
stand and pray with me? This morning our prayer will focus on some of the particular blessings that have made this nation so remarkable. Let us pray. Father, you have blessed our country with great bounty. We are certainly a land of plenty. And for this, God, we're so thankful. And Lord, you have always imbued your chosen ones with bravery and given many the willingness to serve. For this, we thank you. Father, you have blessed this nation with an indomitable spirit and a determination to remain free. Oh Lord, we thank you. And so Lord, we pray this morning that you'll help us always to be grateful for the sacrifices that have been made. Yes, Lord, today we remember the sacrifice that you made. The sacrifices that Jesus paid. But we also remember the sacrifice of that soldier, be it an American or an ally soldier, who gave his life for freedom. And certainly for those soldiers who so often have given their life to keep the United States of America a land of the free. May it become and remain home for the brave. May it always remain so. In Jesus' name, amen. Together, praise to you who dwell among us, keep in kindness by your presence. Arise, O Lord, into your resting place.
You and the ark of your strength.
Let your priests be clothed with righteousness.
Let your faithful people sing with joy.
For your servant David's sake,
do not turn away the face of your anointed.
The Lord has sworn an oath to David.
In truth, he will not break it.
A son, the fruit of your body,
will I set upon your throne.
If your children keep my covenant, and my testimonies that I shall teach them,
Their children shall sit upon your throne forevermore. Praise to you who dwell among us, keeping promise by your presence.
Amen.
Amen.
Blessings be made up for the Lord, made up for the Lord.
sweet spirit here today. And I'm hoping that as you look around and see those who've chosen picnics and parties over game day, Sunday, that you go and share with them what they've missed. Well, they're going to tell you how good the barbecue was, how good the brats were, how good the Polish was, and the potato salad. But can I tell you that there's nothing better? Listen, there's nothing better. As David said, than being in the house of the Lord. And you know what the Bible tells us is that he's going to prepare good things for us to eat. Quite often, many of you tirelessly make sure that you've got something to eat. Somebody say amen. I imagine some of you are kind of anxiously waiting, to get a taste of what's been made today. But here's the thing. Right now, the Bible says, actually, it encourages us to taste and see if he's good. Right now, can you just try now to say, Lord, I want to taste you today. I want to feel you today. I want to know your presence here today. In Jesus' name, I'm asking.
Glorify. Thank you.
church all said?
Amen.
I want to ask if the ushers would prepare to receive our offering this morning. While they're coming around, I'll ask that you open your Bibles to the book of Acts. Oh. Amen. How many of you enjoyed the music this morning?
Amen.
The songs. How about that sweet presence? There's something to be said about good music, isn't there?
Amen.
You know God created all that, right?
Amen.
It's not something, it's something that we should certainly enjoy. And there was a reason that He created it. Part of the reason, it wasn't just to honor Him, no, it was to put us in a mindset and to put us in a spirit where we would be open to receiving certain suggestions. I don't want to preach that message today, but can I tell you, the music that you listen to opened you to certain suggestions. May I suggest this morning that you open yourself to the Spirit and the Word of God. Amen. Amen. Brother Ed, would you pray?
All right. Lord, thank you for the gracious giving. Thank you for the number of the soldiers. Help me, applause. Bless the man who gives the word. Bless our ears to hear the word. Bless us to do the word. Thank you from heaven what these are for. Thank you, praise as we pick up this offering and to use it for the faith. In Jesus Christ, in our prayer.
Amen.
Amen. The book of Acts. It's not a put on. It's just basically, I'll say the book is quite full of stories telling of events that took place. But there's more to it than that. It's more than just a story. This was the beginning. The book of Acts is the beginning of something. And all the Gospels led up to the book of Acts. And then beyond that, it helps us to understand how we're supposed to conduct our lives. Here in the book of Acts, beginning in chapter 1, verse 1, there's a letter that has been written. And it starts, the former account of Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive, at this time restored the kingdom to Israel. And he said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his... The same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Let us pray. Father, we just ask this morning that the Spirit of God would have liberty to teach us, to give us understanding. Lord, we thank you that you have given us the holy book, the Bible. And we understand, God, that this is not just a piece of literature. This is not just a storybook. But it was put together by divine inspiration. It is a work of the Spirit. So God, help us. Help us to interpret through the Spirit what you would be saying to us today. Give us understanding, even as you have given hope, in Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen.
Now, for those of you who have been in church, or you've read the Bible, or been around, we quite often talk about this passage of Scripture. We focus on verse 11. We focus there where these two men, they show up in these white robes, angelic messengers, I'll say, as what we understand them to be. And they deliver a wonderful promise. It's a wonderful promise delivered by the messengers of God. Now, I wonder how many of us, we expect something greater than just an ordinary man dressed up in some synthetic shirt, wearing the wrong shoes. Wait a second. Are you expecting to hear from God today?
Amen.
And when you hear from him, will you be willing to learn what he's telling you and to do what he's asking you to do? You see, here they were standing. They knew Jesus personally. Amen. These were his disciples. They knew who it was, and this has been 40 days now. He had been resurrected from the dead. He came out of the tomb. I seem to remember there was another story too where they were looking in the tomb, and here again there was this angelic being that was there. They were saying, "Hey, why are you looking for the living among the dead?" Wonder, could that have been the same messengers? Does it matter who the messenger of God is?
No.
If it's a messenger of God, should we not listen to him?
Yes.
So they're there and they're saying, why are you looking into heaven? I mean, that is a great promise. That same Jesus that you've just seen, in like manner, he's coming back. How many of you are looking forward to the return of the Lord?
Amen.
And I know that we don't know when it's going to happen. And one of the things that we see in the Bible, it says it's not been given to us to know the times and the season, which has been put under God's authority. In other words, he's saying, listen, our Father who art in heaven, he's got a plan. And it's his plan, and he's the only one that knows what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. Amen?
Amen.
So as we think about this thing, it's still a great promise to know that he's coming back. But what will that mean? It's reassuring to know that same Jesus will return one day, just as the disciples had watched him ascend into the heavens. But today, I want to have you focus your attention on that phrase. This, I want to call it a catchphrase. And that phrase has to do with wait. Why? Why are you gazing? Why are you just still looking? Why standing gazing into heaven? I catch myself from time to time, whether I'm in a building or certainly when I'm outside, and maybe I'm walking along, maybe I'm having a bad day, a good day, or any day, and I catch myself just looking to heaven and wondering what's going on in heaven and when I'm going to be able to go there. I'm not in a hurry, by the way. Or when is heaven going to come to earth? I just ponder eternity. Anybody here ever wonder about eternity?
Amen.
Just so you know, it says that you're going to. The Bible says he has put eternity in the heart of everyone. Did you know that eternity's in your heart?
Amen.
It's in there. Isn't it wonderful to think about this? We've been promised an eternity, every one of us. But what's that eternity going to look like? And that's what I tend to look forward to. And you've heard it said over the years past, don't be so heavily minded, you're of no earthly good. Why, I ask. Wait, why? Why are you standing there? Why are you gazing into heaven? Wait a minute. It's as if, like maybe you've heard the question, you know, somebody says something, like they say, hey, what were you thinking? And do you really think they want to know what you were thinking? Hey, what's on your mind? Do you really think they want to know? Or perhaps it's like, I saw this video recently, and there's plenty of them out there on the internet, and this teacher came in, and I mean, the kids were, they're on the desk, and they're just tearing things up. Now, we never did that in our day, did we? The teacher comes into the class, and she's standing in the doorway, and she says, hey, what's going on in here? Now, I don't think that she wasn't clear on what was happening. I think it was more of a notification of what's supposed to be going on in here. Or how about that time way back in the beginning? I'm talking about the book of Genesis. You know, you've got that man, Adam, and that woman, Eve. And the Lord shows up, and he came into the garden, and he said, Adam, where art thou? Do you really think he didn't know where he was? Or is it more of a rhetorical question, say, hey, what's happened? Do you know where you stand with me now? What's going on here? Where are you? What's the 3 points for this year? Maybe for the rest of your life? You need to know who you are, where you stand, what to do. Why do you stand there gazing? Maybe it's because you don't know who you are. You really don't know. Maybe you do know where you stand, and maybe I'll leave it there. Maybe you're at this moment you could be honest with God and yourself and others and say, I'm really not where I ought to be with the Lord. Why do you stand there gazing? So the question in my text reminds me of all these things. Adam, where are you? And so here we are in our text today. The messengers were not interested in the disciples' real response to the question. Why do you stand there gazing? I think they asked that perhaps maybe they might realize that this wasn't what they were supposed to be doing. They weren't supposed to be just standing around gazing. You see, Jesus had given them specific instructions. So today I want to focus on this particular thought. Why stand ye gazing? And I want to just kind of hit a few points in the scripture. The one thing I want you to hear in verse 4. It says, and being assembled together, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, that you have heard from me. And listen, the question to ask right now is, who were these guys? Not just the 11, who were these people? Knowing who you are, let's find out who they are. You know who they are? This was the infant church. This was the day of the deliverance when the church is about to be birthed. Amen?
Amen.
You got that, Chris? Oh, just so you know, Chris is going to be here with us on the second. Or before. This was a time when the church was about to be birthed. It's about to come to fruition. We're about to see these people assembling together. Later on, you're going to find it wasn't just the 11. Later on, in this upper room, there were at least 120 in that upper room. For us, that would be a good Sunday morning, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But can you imagine? Well, yes, we can imagine. Over the last couple of months, we've had, well, over 100 people in the sanctuary. And you look around this morning and you're wondering, well, where are they now? Do you really care? Or are you still busy gazing? Wondering when you're going to be called out? What if I told you right now you're being called out? No, not out of this world. We've been sent into this world. We're being called to go into this world. We're being called to be light to this world. But maybe some of us were not quite there yet because there is something that we still need. See, they had been told to tarry in Jerusalem. Now, right at this moment, they're not in Jerusalem. They're off someplace else. And I guess most likely they were at Mount Olivet, about a mile away. And they cannot stay on the mountaintop. Some of us, we look for that mountaintop, and we'd like to stay there. You can't stay on that mountaintop, no matter how exciting it was or is. You can't stay there. They had to leave where they were and go to Jerusalem. And when they arrive, when they get there, they're going to have to wait. Because great things were about to happen.
Amen.
In a biblical sense. You see, when the local church obeys this first directive, listen to what I'm telling you. You need to listen to me this morning, because I deal with this on a daily basis. When the people of the church decide to listen and to obey and to do what God has told them, others will come.
Amen.
You say you would like to see those numbers again, those souls sitting in the pews. You say that you would like that, but unfortunately, although you say you love him with your mouth, your heart's deceiving you. When we obey that first direction, others come. And that's important for us to hear this today. Hear the word of the Lord and do it. We've got to stop gazing. We've got to stop just
just imagining, and we've got to get to the obeying. You know what Samuel told Saul? He said that obedience is better than sacrifice. Okay. You know, God puts a pretty big premium on obedience.
Amen.
Obedience caused Jesus to suffer and die on the cross. What did it buy for you? You know, if there's a lesson that we can learn from God dealing with the nation of Israel, it is a lesson of obedience. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, you might want to write this down. I know I had to. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 26, or beginning in verse 26. Right now, how many are gazing? And if someone said, "Hey, look!" Would you look? I gotta take this just for a moment. When we were in school, and it's been a while for me, maybe you guys never did this. We'd be in the classroom, and I'd be one of the group, a few that would be in the classroom first. And what we used to do when kids would come in, I mean, they're just that close to missing the bell. When they come in, they find us, we'd be standing at the door. What do you think they did when they came in? So right now, that's what we're doing. We're looking to the same spot. So that's why I told you, go to Deuteronomy. Amen? Let's all look and see what's there. Because, well, just so you know, back in those days, there was nothing. We weren't looking at anything. We were looking at the crack in the ceiling or something, but there was nothing there. But can I tell you right now? I said, hey, look, there's something to be seen. And he says the very first word is, behold, or look at this. Behold, I set before you this day a blessing and a curse. A blessing if you obey the commands of the Lord your God, which I command you this day. And a curse if you will not obey the commands of the Lord your God. But turn aside out of the way which I command you this day to go after other gods which ye have not known. You know, it's interesting. We're always going to look for something else because we're just kind of, you know, we're tired of the same old thing. Relationships get they get old, and we get marriages they break up because you know it was built on the wrong kind of a foundation. Well, I'm just kind of bored. I'm saying that right now. There was someone who that over the last couple of weeks I had opportunity to speak with a couple of couples. There we go.
A couple of couples
at work.
Yeah,
you got it. And they and I said, what is going on? I want to. Okay, I'm not going to tell you what I wanted to do. I said, what is wrong with you, son? And if you saw his wife, when he said this, well, yeah, I'm just bored. Excuse me? Here's the thing. Many times, that's what happens. We just get bored with it. Can I tell you? There's nothing boring about serving the Lord.
Amen.
Unless you're searching for other gods that you don't know yet. And here's the problem we have. Most of the time, we're going to go search for another God that we don't, that because we don't like the one that we do know, because he doesn't want things done the way we want them done. We're hoping to go find a God that will listen to us. In other words, we want to be God. Hey, God, you're going to listen to me. All right, God said, all right. His response is, listen, obey me, blessings. Disobey me, cursings. Any questions? I set before you this day a blessing and a curse. A blessing if you will obey the commands of the Lord your God. So we see this thing, we're saying, oh, stop gazing and obey the Lord. And then stop gazing and do what he says. Go and wait. In Luke chapter 24, verse 49, it says, and behold, now there it is again, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. I want you to wait there until the promise comes.
Amen.
Listen, when God makes a promise, actually the scripture says, if the promise tarries, wait for it. Amen?
Amen.
It's worth waiting. We're such a rush to go get what we want. We want it hot. We want it now. We want instant this. We want instant that. instant gratification, and then when we're not given it, we're bored. If we have to work for it, we just want it handed to us. But here's the thing, listen, wait to be endued with power. Wait for the promise that God has promised to you. And listen, did you know that God doesn't lie?
Amen.
I mean, how exciting is that, to know that God has made you and me a promise. He made a promise to you. I know very few people who enjoy waiting. That's why fast food joints have done such a great business. Am I right? And then, how many of you know that fast food is probably not good for you? It might taste good, but it is not good for you. I could preach on that and call fast food a sin, because that's what sin is. It feels good for a moment, but it's not good for you. I mean, many not only do not enjoy waiting, but we hate to have to wait. And you know, you can't hurry God. There's a song. You can't hurry God. You just have to wait. He may not come when you want him, but he's always right on time. You can't hurry God. You just have to wait.
Amen.
I was expecting Marty to jump up there and grab his stringed instrument and just start singing me a song, but he didn't do it, so I'm going to go on. So what do you think about these automated checkout lines at the store? Supposedly, it's supposed to speed things up. Am I right? Hey, how many of you love those things? Nobody loves them, do you? I mean, you got one item, right? You got one item, you're going to go to checkout. You know what? I can still remember I got one item. I used to like to go to the express lane, 10 items or less. Man, that gal would ring it up, and then she'd tell me how much I owe. Now I've got to go figure this out first, and then...
Yeah.
Oh, and then it's not enough. I still have to wait for someone to come over and check my work. Okay, anyway. There is a problem. I mean, this self-checkout, this automated stuff, man, what a scam. And are you getting a discount on what you're buying for doing your own work?
Nope.
No. You don't get no discounts. And there's somebody else not getting paid. So I'm still wrong. This is a scam. I mean, you think you're going to get out quicker, but it's not. But there is still another problem. And there is almost always is, right? You still have to wait. I mean, they've got one person now looking over four different, five different, six different, 10 different checkout stations. And don't you love to hear that machine tell you what to do? I have enough trouble when my wife wants to tell me what to do. But I'm not going to say to that machine, yes, dear. I might say, no way. More than that, I'm looking for the person who's been employed to come work there. I have them come over. Would you interpret this for me, would you? Well, I'm not going to get off of that, okay? Here's the thing, though. Let's look at the disciples. Are you ready? They were ready for the kingdom to come. Amen. They were looking forward to what God was going to do and how things would be different when the kingdom came. They were convinced that it was time. And then the tragedy of Calvary, my goodness, well, how much loss, how much suffering. I mean, the Calvary had turned into victory with the resurrection. And you're thinking, all right, after all this is done, how can it get any better? They thought surely now would be the time for the Lord to establish his kingdom, and they were anxious for that to take place. But the Lord rebuked them and reminded them that they were supposed to do something else. Wait. Go back to Jerusalem, he says, and wait for God's power to come upon you. Did you hear that? Go back to Jerusalem. I'll just say this for us. Get yourself back in the altar and look for the power of God to come to you. I mean, their prayer meeting turned into a power meeting.
Amen.
They went to Jerusalem, and they went to that upper room in verse 13. And we know that it would be 10 days before the Holy Spirit would come and empower them
to do the work that God had called them to do. How often I have seen people rush in and they get all zealous about the work of God, and they see this needs to be done, that needs to be done. I'd like to see some of that, where people saw things that needed to be done and they said, I'm ready to do it. But I have seen so many come and they go to do something, but it wasn't something they were equipped to do yet. They had not been empowered. They had not been trained. They call that zealousness of not according to knowledge. Just because you see something that needs to be done, are you the one that should do it? Perhaps, maybe you are. But remember, this is a spiritual thing, isn't it? Knowing who you are, knowing where you stand. It would be 10 days before the Holy Ghost would come. And they didn't know how long it was going to be. It wasn't like they had this ticker up on the wall. 10, 9, 8. No, none of that was happening. All they knew is they had to wait. But they were obedient. Even though they really didn't fully understand what God's plan was or what it would be. Now, there's a great example for us right here. In Psalm 127, I don't know if I've got that in your notes or not, but
yeah.
Psalm 127, I love this. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early and to sit late, to eat the bread of sorrows. For so he gives his beloved sleep. Look at this. Unless the Lord builds the house. But what we see with them is that while they were waiting, they weren't just sitting around eating donuts, drinking coffee. They were busy. While they were waiting, they were busy. They put away all their differences. Did this. They put away all their differences. Remember that thing about a family? They put away their differences. Do you know that there are some people right now that are not in any church anywhere because of you and me, because of us, because of a relationship, because you've not been willing to have that hard discussion where you might have to humble yourself. I've been in this for more than a minute. I began in my ministry. I think it was training, good training for me. I was a pastor of youth and family ministries for several years. And I can't tell you how many times I had to play mediator between family members to get them to come worship together. Can I tell you that a family that prays together will stay together?
Amen.
Did you get that? And you're going to see that, and you will see that in this particular story, as they're up there in the upper room. They put away their differences, and verse 14 says that they prayed together. They studied the word in verse 16, and then they applied the word of God, and then some chose to fill the vacancy that was left by Judas. Remember, there was only 11, now they need to be 12. And they thought to themselves, you know, Jesus had 12, we need 12. And there's some historic and traditional and some spiritual reasons for the 12. We're not going to go into that today. But here's what I learned. This was the first local church business meeting that ever was recorded in history. And you know, it's been tough since we've been here to have business meetings. And the reason being is because so many people say, well, the church can't operate like a business. Oh, yes, it should. That'll be another subject to talk on in the future. Well, it's none of my business. Yes, it is. You can't stay ignorant and expect things to happen. There may be something that you're missing your blessing, or you're missing an opportunity once again to serve in a greater capacity. So here again, stop gazing. Why stand ye here gazing? Why are you just coming to hear? What are you just coming to see?
The Bible says that they were to be his witnesses, and so are we. Amen?
Amen.
You see, when we look at this word witness, it comes from the Greek word martis. And from that same root word, we get the English word martyr. And that was the word used to reference a young man in the New Testament named Stephen. How many of you know that he was the first New Testament martyr? They stoned him. And rather than cursing them, he asked the Lord to forgive them. And that's something.
Amen.
See, a witness is one who is called to bear a record of the truth. A witness is one that bears record of the truth, and that's what we're supposed to be, witnesses. But if you have not got the Spirit, as the Holy Scriptures tells you to, you can't effectively witness. It's not just about having head knowledge. And some of us, we stop ourselves right there and say, well, I really don't know the Scripture that good. I'm academically challenged. I really have trouble reading it, this, that, and the other thing. Well, that's fine, recognizing those things, but here's the deal. Maybe you are academically challenged, but never be challenged when you come to a place where you say, I've got the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Because I promise you, the Holy Spirit makes a difference.
Amen.
It's one thing to know about the Holy Spirit. It's another thing to have fellowship with Him. Amen. And Him with you. They didn't know what would happen in just 10 days, did they? But God did.
Amen.
They're waiting. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, if we look at this, it says, but you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto both Jerusalem and to Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. You see, the Lord knew. Let's personalize this. Jesus knew that he was going to use Peter. And this infant church was going to reach thousands of people with the truth. And did you know, if you look at that, look at Peter. Remember Peter, he's gone through such discouragement in those days earlier. You remember how he denied Jesus, before he was crucified, and basically he separated himself from the disciples. He was an outcast. Remember though that the Lord was about to do something remarkable in him. And when he came, when he was resurrected, when he called the disciples, he said, and Peter also. He called him by name. What if I told you this morning? And he's calling you by name. Sister Donna, he's calling you by name. Marty, he's calling both of you by name. What if I told you he's calling us by name? And maybe like Peter, you have fallen apart. You've walked away. You have departed from the faith for a while. Or maybe you've done some things that were just ridiculous. But that's okay. He's still calling you by name. You see, we're still seeing the effects of what took place on that day of Pentecost. We have the gospel today because they stopped gazing. Did you hear that? We have the gospel of Jesus because they stopped gazing into the sky and they started witnessing. I mean, who is waiting for you right now to come and tell them about the love of God and the way to heaven? Who's waiting for you right now? And do you even care? Show of hands, who wants to get to heaven someday?
Amen.
What if I told you the kingdom of heaven is already here? The kingdom of God. It's already here. Apparently the disciples had missed that conversation that they had before Jesus was crucified. And they were, hey, listen, show us the kingdom. And he said, take us to the kingdom. We can't go where you're going, but wait a minute, where is it you're going? And he said, listen, it talks about the kingdom of heaven. He says, it's even in your heart. Wait a minute, they forgot that, but they're still gazing into the skies, and we're still gazing into heaven, we're still praying, hoping that I got to get to heaven somehow. Wait a minute, we need to get to heaven somehow. There's only one way. He said, well, I believe on Jesus, so that means I'm a shoe-in. Wait, do you really believe on him? Do you really believe that he was the Son of God? Do you really believe that he had the authority of God? And do you believe that anybody today has the authority of God to speak to you the way I'm talking to you right now? You can't talk to me that way. You can't judge me. to. You've already been judged. Here it is.
Amen.
But I've come by to tell you this morning that you're being summoned, that you're being called upon. And God says, listen, you can't make it on your own. You can't come crawling and begging. And it's not about that. You know, the free gift that you got from Jesus at Calvary, did you know that the Holy Ghost comes in like manner as a free gift? It is a second work of grace. In other words, it's a free gift. Well, what do I need to do? I have to believe upon the Lord and be saved. Well, what do I need to do? Well, listen, you may have to seek God for this. Say, this is the gift that I want. This is, Lord, this is really my heart's desire. You may have to make some sacrifices, but here's the thing. What do we learn in the scripture? Obedience is better than sacrifice. Sometimes we think that being obedient is a sacrifice. No, it's not. Being obedient is just the right thing to do.
Amen.
What are you sacrificing? Well, I'm sacrificing what my flesh wants to do. Wait a second. That's what this is about. You're never going to be able to get to heaven in the flesh. Only in the spirit.
Amen.
This is a spiritual book. It can only be understood spiritually. Or we can look at it as a history book, as a good piece of literature, and we can understand the stories, and we can see some of the things in here. But can I tell you that it's going to be the Holy Spirit that's going to make everything clear to you.
Amen.
But not all at once. Once again, you've got to wait for it.
Amen.
So where does this leave us? This leaves us again to say, stop gazing. Because Jesus is coming back. This same Jesus that you saw in like manner, he's coming back. The one who cared for the lost and the dying. The one who wept over hurting people. The one who died and the one who rose again, he's coming back. And when he returns, we will have no more time. No more time to gaze. Did you know the time is short?
Yes.
Amen. No more time to witness to him. When he comes, it's over. No more work for us to do. Why? Because time's up. Time's up. When he returns, listen to this, every one of you right now. If you were sleeping, that's fine up to this point. Wake up. Elbow anybody right now. If they're not listening, I want you to hear this. When he returns, there's something that's going to happen. We're going to have to give an account.
Amen.
What? That's right. Every one of us must give an account. And just to be clear, we're not trying to balance a ledger. Well, I did so much good, which outweighed the bad that I did. That doesn't work. It might work in the mind, and sometimes it kind of works in the world. Sometimes. But it just doesn't work. Well, I've done more good than I've done bad. I wish I could say that. Second Corinthians chapter 5 says this in verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, for everyone will receive the things done in his body according to what he has done, whether it be good or bad. And every time I read that, I just want to sit right down. But can I tell you, every time I've sat down and I had the same thoughts, the same Holy Spirit wells up within me to remind me, you once were lost, but haven't you been found? You say, but God, the problem I've got is, even after I was found, I still got myself lost. Even when I knew what to do, I still did the wrong things. And you know what the scripture says? The Apostle Paul had the same problem. Aren't you glad that after grace comes mercy? Aren't you glad that if you've fallen seven times, get up the eighth time?
Amen.
That's the difference between the saints and the aints. For what we have done will be judged, whether good or bad. So I guess I'll say it again. We need to quit gazing. And realize that we do not have forever. to truly do His will. You might look and see someone who's older and think, well, they've got less time than I do. You don't know that. So we need to quit gazing, and we need to realize that time is short. John chapter 9, verse 4 says this: the night is coming when no man can work. There's a night coming. You say, oh, right, no work. No, you don't get it. We're talking about the work of witnessing. We're talking about the work of ministry. There's coming a time when it's over. Stop gazing. Stop gazing and obey the Lord. Stop gazing. Go and wait if necessary. Stop gazing and let God do some work in your life and in my life and in the world around us and in the lives of our family, our loved ones, our friends, our children. So many Christians, quote unquote, have lost children because they failed to obey God and raise them up in the way that they should go. The most common thing I still hear today, well, I'm going to wait for my kids to come of age and they can make a decision on their own. I don't know about you, but I don't know a child that didn't need to be told to wash their hands. I don't know. I can give you a list of things. You didn't wait for that. Well, that's just something that they have to do. I mean, but wait a second. They need to know what choices need to be made unless they're taught, unless they've been raised up to know the difference between good and evil. Stop gazing. Why? Because Jesus is coming back. So as we consider this challenge that was given to the first church, we need to realize the application for us today. Here's the thing. This is a corporate challenge. I know some of us, we don't like to hear that word because it sounds so businessy, right? No. It's a challenge for you and me together. That's corporate. It is a corporate challenge to the Lighthouse Village Church and all those who are affiliated. Those of us who claim to be faithful, we're faithful in attendance, but if all you do is come and sit and watch, sit and gaze, you're not faithful in the work that you've been called to do. It's a corporate challenge, and it's also an individual challenge for every one of us here today. This is on the day of Pentecost. There they were waiting. And it came like the sound of a mighty rushing wind. Can you imagine what it would be like right now? If the doorway of heaven was opened up, what kind of noise would there be when the Spirit come rushing down? What would it sound like? What will it look like? It's time for us to stop gazing. Get to work for the Lord. Some of you are doing it. I want to commend you, and I want to exhort you, and I want to encourage you to do it even more. Some of us will say, well, you know, I've been telling them for years, you know, and they didn't listen. Tell them again. Tell them again. Tell them again. Tell them what? Tell them about the love of God. Tell them about Jesus. Tell them about the story. And listen, don't do it just from your head and just from your own heart. Do it in the Spirit of God, in the Spirit that you were meant to do it in. You've been endued with power. You've received the gift of salvation. Now the gift of the Holy Spirit is available. You say, well, I don't really know how to talk. I'm not sure what to say. Paul said this, though I speak with the tongue of men and angels. Wait, hold on. No, I can interpret tongues. Wait, hold on. He said, I'd still rather speak five words of my own understanding. If nothing else, if you don't know anything else, tell them about the Jesus. Tell them about the gospel. Tell them about how Jesus was born. He died. He suffered and he died. He rose again. And the Holy Spirit is here right now pulling on us to come and receive that free gift. Too often we let our agendas, we let our special other activities take precedence over what God has called us to do. I want to encourage you to heed the challenge I'm making to you right now. You'll have opportunity today, in many cases, there'll probably be more people with your family, or you'll be with more people and family and friends over a holiday weekend like this.
rather than sharing your latest joke or your latest complaint or your view on politics, wait, how about you tell them about Jesus? Say, hey, have you considered that Jesus is coming back soon? Let me tell you what I do. I don't take no for an answer. You know what no means for me? Not now. If not now, when? Maybe you're thinking this morning, as many thought many times, well, maybe I'm not the one. If not you, then who? Have you ever had somebody that you had to say, hey, listen, you really need to go see a doctor? Someone who's, it's obvious that they've got a problem, and you're willing to tell, hey, you need to go see. How about you learn to, hey, did you come to Jesus? Have you received him? Let me ask you this. Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? And then the question is, okay, if you have, are you obeying the Spirit? Are you doing what God has commanded you to do? And if you have, do it more. And more often. Amen? I want to thank you this morning for coming. For those who invited, for those who just came to stay, I just want to welcome you into this. these great to you, would you put your hands together? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, why stand ye gazing? Quite often we find ourselves wondering what the future is going to hold. Let me explain something to you. You need to embrace life now. And remember that God is the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. Amen? And we're going to just take a moment here because we're going to pray right now. Sister Cheryl is, how many years of marriage did they just celebrate? 70 years of marriage they just celebrated here not too long ago. Right now, they're in urgent care. We don't have any details. How many of you think you need details?
No.
Not this guy. But how many of you believe that the Holy Spirit of God, he's not just here?
Amen.
He's certainly not just here.
Amen.
Amen. He's here, there, and everywhere.
Yes.
Would you lift up your hand right now? Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we lift up this man, Lord, who is in the hospital, and Lord, all of his family and friends. Lord, we ask God for you to bless them in such a way. And Lord, we can stand here and say that he's lived a good long life. And Father, we know that we would just assume that he's been around well longer. Whatever needs to be done, Father, Lord, that you would preserve his life, that you would heal him, that you would, Lord, as the word says, restore his youth. We come to you, Jesus. You are the healer. You sent the Holy Spirit, and we've asked the Holy Spirit now to go and do a work. Even as you've asked us today, go and do likewise. Lord, let us be the purveyors of the gospel, ones who speak about Jesus and walk in his ways. That Lord, that even the prayer that we pray right now, we know that it doesn't fall on deaf ears. But Lord, I know that you desire to reward those who diligently seek you. Today, Lord, our reward would be to hear of a person that's been healed. A reward to hear that someone has been saved. God, thank you for your son. And Jesus, thank you for being obedient to ask the Father to send the promise. We have received it. We believe it. And now we're going to do it in Jesus' name. And the whole church said, amen. 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 May the Lord bless you. May his countenance shine upon you. And may by his Holy Spirit bring you peace.